I want to welcome you to our online service. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. We have so much to rejoice in Jesus, don't we? We're going to look at the book of Colossians chapter 2 as we continue on in our series on the book of Colossians, written by the Apostle Paul to the church of Colossae. And Paul wrote to them to keep them from being deceived by false teachings about who Christ is. The Fire Bible says about these false teachings that were endangering the church of Colossae that whatever it was, it seems to have been undermining some of the people's dependence on Christ as a central focus of their faith and life. And oh, that we would not lose sight that Christ is the central focus of our faith and our life. I'm going to read the text this morning, starting in verse 1. For I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you and for those at Laodicea and for all who have not seen me face to face, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I say this in order that no one may delude you with plausible arguments. For though I am absent in body, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ. Let's pray. Father, I ask that you'd speak, that we would have ears to hear from you today. We thank you for your word that is living and active. Pray that you would sanctify us in the truth. Your word is truth. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we're only going to make it actually through the first part of verse 2 today, but I wanted to read it in context so we would have that in our minds. Colossians 2 verse 1, once again, let me read it, says this. For I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you and for those at Laodicea and for all who have not seen me face to face. Paul wants these Christians to know how much he cares for them, that he loves them. Even though he has not met them or seen them face to face, he has a great compassion and a care for these Christians, both the Christians in Colossae and the Christians in Laodicea. The Apostle Paul wanted them to know how much he cared for them and that they wouldn't be deceived by the enemy. I wonder, how about you? Is your love for people evident? Do people really know that you care about their souls, that you care about the decisions they're making in their lives, that you care about truth, that you're compassionate towards them? Paul is certainly compassionate towards the Colossians and the Laodiceans. Now, it's interesting because Colossians was written sometime around 58 to 62 AD. And you may have heard of Laodicea before, and you wonder where, and you're trying to go through your memory and think about where you've heard of the Laodiceans. Well, in Revelations chapter 2 and 3, we read of these seven letters to the church, to the churches in Asia Minor there. And Paul had good reason to be worried about the Laodiceans because the Apostle John in 95 AD, so some 35 years later, would write about this church and what a desperate situation they were in. I want you to hear these words. This is Revelation chapter 3, starting in verse 14. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy for me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich, and white garments, so that you may clothe yourselves, and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen, and salve to anoint your eyes, so that you may see. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The only church in Revelation of these seven churches, the only church that there's nothing positive said about them is the church of the Laodiceans. There's no commendation at all, no compliments to them. They were a church that was in a miserable state. They thought they had it all together. They probably had the fog machines and the laser lights and had wealth and abundance. But spiritually, they were poor. They had fine clothing, but spiritually, they were naked. They were without clothing spiritually. They thought they saw clearly when, in fact, they were deluded and blinded. Laodicea definitely had some issues. And so Paul, in 58 to 62, is showing his concern for the Laodiceans. And we realize that he had great reason to be concerned about them and being concerned about the Colossians as well. Laodicea is a picture of the dangers of being a lukewarm church and a lukewarm Christian. God is calling you to passionately pursue Him, to know Him and to make Him known, to grow in your faith and develop. Oh, that you would seek Him and not be sidetracked and not be confused, but that you would pursue Him. Pursue Him in repentance, pursue Him in faith, pursue Him in trust, pursue His calling upon your life. Be obedient and watch what God does in and through you. Have you turned your life over to the one who gave His life for you? Have you put your faith in Christ and received Him? And then are you following His path and living your life for all that He has for you? I trust that you are. What was Paul wanting so badly to happen to these people's lives in Colossae and the people's lives in Laodicea? He wanted that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love. Colossians 2, verse 2, the beginning of verse 2. The New Living Translation, that was the ESV, the New Living Translation says it like this: I want them to be encouraged and knit together by strong ties of love. This was Paul's desire for them because this was God's desire for them. And this is God's desire for us as well. Amen. So I want to apply this to our lives today. God's desire is that we would be encouraged and knit together in love. This is God's purpose and God's plan and God's desire for us. Oh, that He would do it in a mighty way here and now. Church, we are God's people. We are one body, many parts, as Paul wrote to the Corinthians. You have a part to play. You are important to this body of believers, right? And we're all different. Some of us are ears, some of us are eyes, some of us are fingers, if you follow that analogy of being one body. But we all have a function, and it's incredibly important that we are part of this church fellowship, that we gather with God's people so that we would impact them with the gifts that God has given us. You may not realize how much you encourage others when you're here. You may not realize even how much a conversation or a prayer with somebody or a word of encouragement or hope means to somebody else's life. Some of our encouragement is more intentional, but some just happens naturally as we as God's people gather. I was with the men's group this last week, and just I was so encouraged by the conversations that were happening that it was just this encouragement that came as the guys were pointing out things from the scripture that have impacted them as they were sharing with each other. And I'm so thankful for that. God wants to build us up in our faith as we gather with His people, one body, many parts. The Greek word here is parakaleo, and it means to console, to encourage, to exhort, to strengthen. This is what God wants to do in us, and this happens as we submit to Him and gather with His people and allow the Spirit to speak to our hearts. We all need Barnabas is in our life. Do you remember Barnabas from the Bible? Barnabas was an encourager. And in fact, his name means son of encouragement. I read about a woman who once had a tremendous career as a singer, but she had been very discouraged by the criticism of a teacher she had. And eventually she was so discouraged, she quit singing altogether. Her talent lay dormant until an exuberant young salesman began courting her. And on occasion, when she would hum a little tune or a melody would burst forth, he would marvel at the beauty of her voice. "Sing some more, honey. You have the most beautiful voice in the world," he would say. He showered her with praise. Not too surprisingly, her confidence returned and she began to receive invitations to sing again. She eventually married the good finder and went on to a successful career. We all need those people that encourage us, right? That help us to see the value of who we are in Christ Jesus, right? We need people to come along and say, "Can I pray for you?" We need people to come along and say, "It will get better. Keep pursuing Christ. Keep following Him. Keep seeking His help." We all need people to say, "Let's walk through this together. You're not alone, but I'm here." We all need people to come along and say, "God hasn't forgotten you." We all need people to come along and say that God is merciful and gracious, that His mercies are new every morning. Great is His faithfulness. We all need encouragement, don't we? And that means we need to gather with God's people so that we can receive that encouragement. This world can be a very discouraging place. But amongst God's people, we find the hope and the courage and the encouragement that we desperately need as we pursue Christ and all that He has for us. Not only do we encourage one another in the Lord, but as we gather with God's people, we are knit together. And this was Paul's desire for the Colossians and the Laodiceans, and it's God's desire for us today, right? That we would be knit together. Isn't that a beautiful picture of this fellowship and this closeness, that we are knit together as God's people? This is a cohesiveness, a wholeness that begins to happen as we live life with one another and serve one another. Life groups are going to start up after Easter, after Resurrection Sunday. And I want to encourage you, invite you to be a part of the life groups as we pursue all that God wants to do in us as He knits us together as His people in love. You know, it's really amazing that you can get such a diverse group of people that gather each week, and yet we love each other so much, and we are one body, many, many parts. And this is because of our faith in Christ Jesus, who gave Himself for us. In Christ, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female. And the point being made is that in Christ Jesus, we all come to Him for salvation, and now we are His, right? We are His people. We are one in Him. And by the way, I believe that one of the devil's strategies during this COVID time has been to try to keep God's people apart. In fact, with this pandemic right now, I think a lot of people have been kept from the encouragement that comes as God's people gather. And I just want to say that maybe you've been unable to gather, and I just want to tell you that we love you so much, and this is why we're providing the online service each week as well. And we understand that not everybody's able to gather. And so know that we care about you, and if you need anything, please call, please receive prayer. Please send us an email if that works for you, and just let us know how we can be praying, because we are in this together. Amen. But let me also encourage you, if you can gather and you're not in a situation where you're unable to gather, would you make an effort to gather with God's people? It is essential that we function in all that God has for us, and we're knit together in love. We encourage one another when we are able to be with one another. And if you're unable to be with the church fellowship, can I also encourage you to reach out to others that may need your encouragement? Because there's other people that are in a similar situation to yours, perhaps, that would need to know that they're not alone, but that if God is for us, who can be against us? Now, there are some people that are looking for a perfect place, and I just want to make it clear that there's no such thing as a perfect church, right, here and now. Of course, on this side of heaven, there's no such thing as a perfect body of believers. But I have never seen as an amazing body of believers as this one. This is an amazing church that cares for one another and loves one another. This is a great place to put down roots and grow and be knit together with each other in love. We are stronger together than we are apart. If the devil can isolate you, he can destroy you. Did you hear what I said? I think it's really important that we get this. We are stronger together than we are apart. If the devil can isolate you, he can destroy you. And so look for ways to be plugged into the body and be of encouragement to others as we are knit together in love and continue to pursue Christ with all that we have and all that He has for us. Unity doesn't mean uniformity. We're different. And that's what we need. But we are also one body with many different parts. And so you matter, and I just want to make that very, very clear. Next time in this series, we'll talk a little bit about the dangers of progressive Christianity. And I just want to make you aware of that, that there's this really dangerous movement out there that questions the authority of Scripture and questions what Scripture says on important moral issues. And so we'll talk more about that, but I just wanted to kind of present that as something that we'll be looking at next time. As we draw to a close this morning, I want you to know how much I love you as a congregation. This serving here at Sandy Assembly of God is truly such a great privilege to my wife and I, and we love this church so incredibly much. And I wanted to communicate with you. Many of you have already heard, but we feel, Elizabeth and I feel, that the Lord is asking us to step away from pastoring this tremendous church because he has a new season, something else for us. And I believe that that means he has something else for this church. And so I'm praying diligently that the Lord will lead the right shepherd to come. We're going to be here for a while, so you know we're not leaving in the next few weeks. We'll be here for through April for sure, and likely end of May. But I just want you to know how much we love you. I was at a pastor's conference 2 years ago, and the speaker was speaking about missions, and he said that in America there's one Christian worker to about every 1,100 people. And he said in Europe it's something like one Christian worker to every 90,000 people. And when he said that, it really spoke to my heart, because I realized that, you know, that there was a great need there. And he gave the altar call and invited people forward. And he also mentioned in other parts of the world it's even less. There's even a greater need also for more Christian workers to go. But he gave an altar call: if you're willing to go, would you come forward? And I went forward, because I'm always willing to be wherever God wants me to be, though I treasure being here in Sandy so much. And as I went forward, I felt overcome with the presence of God. I could not stop weeping. And I believe the Lord put my mind at that altar: Jeremy, I'm calling you guys to plant a church in Norway. And so I called Lisbeth, who wasn't with me at the time because she was studying for her nursing degree. And so she was at an out-of-town clinical. And I told her about the calling that I felt God speak, and she wasn't there. So she began to pray that God would also speak to her. And throughout some time, the Lord gave her some scripture and verses, and through a situation, he really answered and showed that this was how he was moving and calling. But when I left that conference, the next day, which was a Wednesday, I came into the sanctuary of the church, and the worship band was about ready to practice before the midweek service. And Tawny Rogers in our church, she looked at me as I came into the sanctuary, and she said, "Jeremy, what's the spiritual climate like in Norway? Could you ever imagine living there?" And when she said that, the very next day after at that altar, I felt God call me. It just ministered to my heart in such a deep way. And I felt the Lord was confirming this is his call for us. So I'd like to close us in prayer today. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your mercy and your grace. We ask that you would grow us, that you would help us to pursue you with all that you have for us. Pray that we'd be obedient. Pray that we would receive your mercy and grace and repent if there are things that don't belong in our lives. I pray for great unity, that you would knit us together as a body of believers. I pray it would be evident and obvious to the world. They'll know that we're your disciples by our love for one another. May we be a church that builds one another up and encourages one another in the faith. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you.
He who was before there was light walked across the pages of time. He who made every living thing. Son of God. Oh.